check. Yeah. I just want to thank Rashmi for inviting me to this evening to have a conversation with a photographer that I've now almost known for the years that I've started Photo Inc., which is about 13 years. I was just a young, I'd just come back from New York and I was thinking of starting a photography agency and I'd come to Bombay. And she was kind enough not just to meet me, but also we formed an early bond which we've sort of developed over the years, and it's only back in 2010 that we actually started to work together as a gallery and a photographer. To my mind, Ketaki Sheth has always interested me as a photographer, primarily because if you've studied her work or looked at the three books, and especially the one that's come out now, her entire oeuvre has traversed the many, many different genres in photography, and she's done it with great elan and skill. And this is something that we would like to discuss and have a conversation now, tonight. From her early beginnings with Bombay Mix, which was the street photographs of Bombay, to the stage portrait, which she explores in Twin Spotting, we finally come to a certain grace where she sort of borrows from both the documentary aspect in photography, as well as portraiture and street photography, and it all comes together in this new book that she's just done. And this versatility is what's always interested me, because for most photographers that I've encountered or worked with or known, you tend to find that they sort of work with a particular style, and we sort of recognize that over their careers. Well, in Ketaki's case, we've seen the last 20 years that she's managed to sort of keep sort of moving on, departing from what she's done in the past, and sometimes returning to it. So this versatility that you've managed to sort of imbibe in your practice, and the beginnings in Bombay Mix, I mean, how do you sort of see that? Because you're sort of going back and forth in terms of your own photography.
Yeah. I think Bombay Mix was really born out of tutorials with Raghubir Singh, who was a regular visitor at my parents' home and who would be extremely annoyed if I didn't have anything for him to see or chuck. He was a hard taskmaster, and in those days I would get up in the morning and follow the light and follow a news item or get into a situation in Bombay. And I was then regularly shooting every day, which is now not what I do. Now, as it happens, for various reasons, I look at a project and then I try and complete it. So Bombay Mix was really kind of learning about photography and making mistakes and showing them to Raghubir. And then after he died, although he knew about Twin Spotting, I just came back to my dark room in Manik and I looked at all the old negatives and I just pulled out some from that time. I think it was more a kind of sentimental exercise, really, than I hadn't planned a book or anything, you know.
But the shift that you did with Twin Spotting, not just a shift, you know, between two different kinds of ways of photographing, you know, you had the street and then you go back into a more staged portrait style. How did that happen?
Well, it happened because I married Aurobind and I went to live in London, where I didn't feel that free on the streets. It's as simple as that. And Raghubir had insisted, I'm very slow to change, I embrace technology. What is the word Aurobind says? I'm a Luddite, but whatever it is. So Raghubir had insisted that my father, on one of his Japanese trips, got me a Mamiya 6 medium format camera, which is now 28 years old, and I now have two bodies, and they've served me really well. But for 2 years, the camera just lay in my cupboard, because of course I didn't want to change from what I was doing. But it was sitting in London in our new flat, and Aurobind wearing a suit and going off to work, and I wasn't used to this at all. And I was also not used to just sitting in a home, that I decided that I must pull out the two cameras. Well, I had only one then. I bought a second one soon after. And start looking at portraits and where I could go into homes and away from the street. And Aurobindo was so resistant about his Patel jeans that it got me more curious about them. So, of course, here we were staying, you know, he was the most unlikely Patel. He didn't own a business. He didn't own a car. We lived in a, you know, very bohemian apartment. And so I said, just dig into these Patels. I must find out what you're all about, you know. So, of course, at every corner store, there was a Patel tobacconist or a newspaper vendor. So Aurobindo said, if you really want to get into this, I'll start saying yes to invitations. I said, yes, start saying yes. So we were at a Diwali party in Kent, and only Patels. And Aurobindo was busy showing me off as his non-Patel wife from Bombay. And they were all so proud because they wanted to tell me all about their great, you know, the pyramids they have, the caste system they have. And like all Gujaratis, they're so systematic, it's frightening. So out came all these yellow phone books with their names, their ages, how many children they have, you know, what their income was, which gaon they were from, Saat gaon, Chhattis gaon, Satais gaon, whatever it was. And I learned only then that Aurobindo and Sardar Patel share the same village, sitting in Kent. So anyway, we came home, and Aurobindo had just set up a lovely Apple computer for me, and I started punching in all this data, and I just found tons of twins. I think later I was to realize that in any large population, and my God, the Patels are large, you're bound to find, I think it's, what is the one in 90 is an identical twin or whatever. So I found all these twins, and it was a great way of seeing England, because I was not a housewife, I was not a tourist, I was a photographer, and I wanted to see the country as a photographer. So it meant that I went north, south, east, west, by buses, trains, taxis, looking for twins.
But this, the idea to sort of include the Patel twins in India, how did that sort of, you know, how did those seeds take root?
I guess because by then I learned about their Charotar villages back home, because these are all people who come from a particular large district. And of course they all had relatives who had twins. So I said I would be able to get rural landscapes, because most of the Patels in Charotar were farmers. And in England, of course, they were pharmacists and doctors and engineers and very English in many ways, but terribly Gujarati in their, you know, way of just wanting to stick with each other. I think that's changing though now.
Both your projects, whether it was Twin Spotting or now With a Certain Grace, largely reside in Gujarat or about Gujaratis. And here's a tricky question, because Ketaki doesn't speak very good Gujarati as far as I understand.
I don't speak Gujarati.
Doesn't speak at all, though she understands. Now, as far as, I mean, in the many conversations you and I have had, you've talked about this very cosmopolitan upbringing, where this divide, or rather this, the Gujarati in you was sort of almost sort of subsumed. And it's only now that we see that, I mean, you're attributing this to your marriage with Aurobindo, but I almost sort of feel there is a desire or some need where you're exploring this return to your own roots. And this is probably especially after your father has passed on.
Yeah, I think I felt it when he passed away. But he was such an incredible man that he actually got me excited about going to his ancestral home. And it took a lot to get me excited about seeing things like that, because he said, I'm going to hire a bus and the whole family is going to sit in it and we're all going to sleep two nights there, and I'm going to have a Maharaj come and cook the food that I grew up eating. And of course, I didn't have that background at all. And many of my cousins sitting here did, because my father came from quite a traditional joint family. And my mother is anything but traditional, so we moved out, you know, soon after. So I don't speak Gujarati, but I do feel Gujarati, you know.
But not being able to speak Gujarati, and these both these projects have, you know, they demand that sort of language as a way to sort of access these worlds. Yeah. How were you able to sort of bridge that? You talk about Farida and you talk about various people who've helped you, but how do you manage to bridge that?
Farida wasn't with me every time. But I think speaking in Hindi gets you pretty much everywhere in Gujarat. So I didn't find language was a problem. I love the food, so I had no problem.
Now, with the Siddhi, we see a very different approach vis-a-vis your picture making, and a very sharp departure from the way you photographed twins in England as well as in Gujarat. How did you? I mean, what were your thoughts when you went about making those shifts and turns, at least while photographing the Siddhis? Because we call it a book of portraits.
Yeah.
But it's a very different book of portraits when you look at twins. And, I mean, I don't know, for an audience, would they be able to sort of easily remark that these are both books are by the same photographer? Because they are dramatically different in approaching the portrait.
See, I think with the Patels, it's quite easy to read their nuances, and it's quite easy to engage almost immediately when you're in their homes. But with the Siddhi, I was an obvious outsider, and I will continue to be, you know. So it's a small community. They're very inclusive. They like to marry within their own community. And I think at first they just sort of just tolerated me. But then once they saw me there all the time, I can't say I ever became a fly on the wall, because that was wrong. But they started accepting me with my camera, and they'd say, photo wali aai che, photo wali aai che. But so sometimes being an outsider also gives you a distance. And I think that distance sometimes can work also when you're composing a picture or doing a portrait, where you don't feel you have to get into having a long conversation with somebody's Masi or Dadi or, you know. And with Uras, if I just found the loban too much or the drumming too loud, I could just disappear, you know, without anyone saying that where is she, or she should have been here, and I could come back after half an hour.
So no, but my question actually is more to do with the way you approach the portrait.
Yeah.
Whereas with twin spotting, it was the very formal staged portrait.
Yeah.
And then you abandoned that approach while you're making these.
Yeah. I think there was a difference, because when I was photographing the Patel twins, I always had just an hour, if even that. My journeys to and fro were much longer than the actual time, because as everyone knows here, the Patels are really busy worms, and they're often living above their shop, which they run for 24 hours. So first they asked me whether I was going to take money from them to take pictures, and so I said no, and they wanted to know, because their time was so valuable, you know. So I had to quickly, you know, compose a picture in my head, you know. Upon arrival, I often didn't meet that person again, you know? Whereas with the Siddhi, I could keep going back, which can sometimes not be such a good thing, because then you keep going back and it never ends, and you don't know then when you're editing. You need that distance, you know? So I think I had time with the Siddhi and I didn't have it with... And I think that definitely may have colored how I took the pictures.
To sort of delve back into the time that you were making the twins' portraits,
yeah.
That was also a time you talk about your relationship with Raghubir,
yeah.
And how it was transforming, and it was also a point at which you had already started making the work without sharing it with him till you absolutely felt it had come together as a body of work.
Yeah.
Whereas with Bombay Mix, you were constantly showing him every contact sheet.
Yeah.
And were you worried that he would react or respond differently to an approach that you were taking, which is entirely different from something that he had done in his own practice?
Except that he had always told me that I should come closer up to people and try the portrait, which is why in his own way he had negotiated the Mamiya, because maybe for him my street pictures just weren't unique, you know, to his very experienced eye. He did really like the twins' work. Aurobind then, and by that time Raghubir had moved to Brighton. He was staying with his friend Partho Mittar. So we got to see him regularly, and his publisher was in London because he was doing River of Colour. So Aurobind and I were party to his many arguments with Richard Schlagman. And at the same time, he would be looking at my twins. And, you know, London was so full of photography that he would say, go out and see how August Sander uses his edges. Go out and see the portraits of so-and-so. Go to this exhibition. Go. And I think while working and looking at great pictures and having someone encourage you, it's quite a privileged situation.
But we all know that Raghubir was the quintessential color photographer, and he never ever embraced black and white photography the way you did. But he's played such an important role in your life, both as a mentor, as a friend. It's intriguing to me that you never chose to photograph in color all these years.
Yeah, as I said, I'm just a very lazy person. So I just stuck to what I knew. But, you know, Raghubir's closest friend was a black and white photographer. And his name was William Gedney.
Okay.
And I've spent a lot of time with William Gedney in his dark room. And, you know, he was one of those Renaissance people who knew not only everything about photography, but about literature and music. And he was a very close friend of Raghubir's. So in Bill, he had his black and white. In fact, he would always tell me, learn to print from Bill and, you know, learn about black and white from Bill.
Now, looking back at the Siddhis, I mean, we've been talking about how you're contemplating moving to color. It's just a contemplation which might take another year or, I don't know, 2 years.
No. It's going to happen much sooner.
Much sooner. But now when you look back at the Siddhi and you look at, as you described, just the cover image, do you sort of feel that this book could have actually been made in color? Given the fact that you photographed largely so many marriages, rituals,
births. You know, when I look behind the Mamiya, I just see black and white. So I wasn't really even looking for color. But I tell you where I really missed it. Was when you organized for me to shoot in the Pilbara. And I was the slowpoke who had to crank my, you know, 120 film and this whole slow process. Unlike Bharat, I wasn't able to see my images that night. And, you know, I had to wait for it to be processed. The colors of the Pilbara were just amazing with that green grass and that red ground. And I think I really felt like moving to color as a photographer then.
For as long as I've known you, you've sort of resisted moving to the, you know, digital medium. And I think that resistance is wearing thin now. But what has been the major reservation towards moving to a technology that is by and large being embraced by all your peers now?
Just a thick brain.
No, but I mean,
I'm getting there. I'm whittling it down, and, you know, I'm getting there. Aurobind sometimes loses his cool with me, but
But what was it about the darkroom process that really excited you? Because we know so there's so few photographers left even in India today who work with film and who work with silver gelatine prints. And I mean, all her black and white photographs are printed on silver gelatine paper, which in India has actually more or less vanished. There are only a few custom printers left in the world. So if one has to have Ketaki make any prints, one has to plan this 3 times a year because it just doesn't happen.
It's, you know, terrible, and it's ending. And that's it. It's been too frustrating.
So in terms of now moving towards digital, what are your plans in terms of how you want to... I mean, what is it that you're thinking of working on? I know that you want to keep this under the carpet for a while.
No, I've just got a few ideas in my head, and there's no point talking about them because my ideas keep changing. But I've got to get that camera out of the cupboard first and learn how to use it. And then I'll be able to talk about what I'm going to shoot. So really, I've got lots of young photographer friends who are all willing to get my books and give me lessons in digital photography. Raj, are you here? He's going to give me a lesson. No, he's not come.
Just to now rewind a little bit back to this idea of the community, especially because we are here for the release of this book, there's always that danger of when you photograph a community that's either dwindling or in numbers, or it's a small community that's, you know, on the margins, of